in my big dream imagining, we get to distill the deepest stories and the truths that come out of community and out of history. When we have our voices heard and have our messages heard, we become leaders. Yitzap Oweliel, Siaya, Siem, Sialakwa, Ich Imachne Eten, Antha Jada Gabrielle Pape, Antha Wu Wasselwat. Welcome to the Drawing Wisdom video podcast. We're in season 3. This is episode 2. Where we complete our conversation with Michelle Good. Michelle, it's really, really nice to see you. You know, when you were writing your book, when you were writing Five Little Indians, mm-hmm. did you feel like you were writing it?
Good question. Sometimes I did, you know, like sometimes it was an expression of my intention. But when I got into the zone, right, there's the magic zone of writing, it really felt like I was a scribe, right? That, as you know, especially with certain characters, right, I was, you know, I mean, I lived with them for 9 years, these characters. It took me 9 years to write that thing. And, you know, and I'd be writing away, right, you know, and I would hear one of them say, I wouldn't say that, right, you know, right, it's like, smarten up, Michelle, you know, that's right. But, you know, and yeah, you know, a lot of the revision and a lot of the, you know, backspacing and, you know, starting over was feeling that I was hearing these stories, that I wasn't necessarily creating these stories, that I was hearing these stories, and you know, and that I had an obligation to what I was hearing. I mean, lots of it is me, obviously, right? But, you know, lots of it. I just firmly believe that there was so much influence from the other side in terms of this book. So much influence. And, kind of like my life went upside down and fell apart. And the only thing I could do was this book. That's the only thing I was allowed to do. The only thing I was permitted to do was this book. And if that's not an indication, then I don't know what is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, I know I texted you right after I finished reading your book, but yeah. I don't know that I, in full expression, or even if I have full expression for how transformational it was for me to visit and sit with each of the characters of the people who you brought forward in the book, or who mm-hmm. Offered themselves to you to tell the story. And I felt so I just deeply loved each of them, but also that I was allowed to love them, that we so rarely see those books where we fall in love with our people, and where you revealed the many, many ripples, the ripple effect of what their experiences had been. And also I was shattered a great deal of the time reading the book. Like, I don't often have to put a book down and walk away, but I would close the book and I would put it down and I just like, I need to step away because this is too much for me right now. But then I would miss them and I'd want to come back and see how they're doing.
That's the magic of the book, right? That's the magic of the book. Yeah. And I can't take credit for that. I mean, that was something that was a gift to me that I gifted to the book. And, you know, but you are not the only person that has said that. There has been such a phenomenal response to this book. And you know, overwhelmingly positive, all right? And the negative responses are very telling, right? And And I actually value them because it gives me insight. Like, the one I'm thinking about right now, because it was fairly recent, was some, you know, somebody said, you know, it was a really great book. I really enjoy it. What a wonderful, blah, 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 you know, all that positive stuff. And they said, except for the fact that the characters, okay, this was the words, the characters reek of education and refinement. Which, of course, they don't, right? I mean, the writing itself, okay, like the narration between the moments when the characters are speaking and, you know, engaging and so on, that may reek of my education and refinement, but the characters themselves don't. And then that was sort of my first thought about it. And then I thought, wait a minute. My characters are insightful, okay? When they speak about, like when Kenny is saying to Lucy, or maybe I can't remember just off the moment, but they're saying, you know, I didn't survive. Do you feel you survived? You know, and basically the thing is, you know, am I the person that walked in? Is that the same person that walked out? And I realized that, you know, what this person was saying is that my Indians weren't stupid enough.
Yeah.
And I think that if I had the opportunity to speak to that person and I told her that's what she was saying, she would be mortified. She would be horrified and say, no, I'm not. And I would say, yes, you are. And, mm-hmm. you know, but that is the upside of, you know, sort of, you know, reviews like that where people make comments like that, is it gives me the opportunity to talk about them to you and to, you know, and it pinpoints again the challenges of perception and misperception that we face, you know, mm-hmm. just trying to live in the world, right? And people seeing us in such a inaccurate way. Yeah.
Yeah, you know, there's another thing that your book did, and which is totally preposterous and is, you know, says way more about me than about anybody else, but I felt really seen in reading your book. And what I mean by that is, through a great deal of my own trauma and some of it being intergenerational and inherited from my family, yeah. I felt like the beautiful moments and the beautiful insights and the gentleness that all of your characters had, I felt like I can still have all of my beautiful moments and my gentleness, and I am not just a big ball of traumatic mess, that I am this No. whole big person. And Yeah. so seeing that and the interactions of that, and even the pain and the messiness, helped me feel very seen. And you know, there's a couple of books in my life that I've read that I like to pack around the physical book afterwards, yeah. because yeah. then I feel like I'm still in it somehow.
Yeah.
No, yeah, in it.
Yeah, in it. Yeah. No, and I no.
And
I,
that was I one of those.
Yeah. You know, and I mean, when you know, one of the things and one of the reasons that it took so long to write was to ensure that the characters were not cardboard cutouts, right? That, you know, that they had that multi-layer of being a mess and being injured and being irreparable in some ways, but also being funny and deeply loving and loyal and, you know, ready to go if the need was there. And you know, I mean, people want to say, oh, multi-dimensional characters, but that's not really what I'm getting at. What I'm getting at is character representations that are truthful of what we have had to be as people who have been institutionally subjected to trauma, institutionally and systemically subjected to trauma. And by systemically, I mean by law, you know, things like the outlawing of the potlatch and the Sundance and, you know, all of those things that became the law of the land, that that were fundamentally traumatizing to us. And, you know, that we are all those things, but here we are, right? No matter, you know, the most powerful empires on the earth, you know, the Spanish Empire, the British Empire, the French Empire, you know, sought to destroy Indigenous people, and here we are, right? And it's, you know, I sometimes just think, you guys should just pay attention, right? Like, you know, the Roman Empire fell, you know, all of these, you know, ancient empires fell and were destroyed. Not us. I mean, we were around during the time of the Roman Empire and all that jazz, and we're still here. And we're still here, you know, injured and compromised and modified and all of those things, but the heart and soul of us is still here. And if people paid attention, you know, they might learn something phenomenal, right? But, you know, and I have a book of essays coming out in the end of May, and I love it because it gave me an opportunity to rant about, you know, all of these kinds of things. But, you know, one of the things that I am dedicated to is getting underneath the myth of Canadian history, right? Mm. To get underneath it and to, you know, put it in the mirror for people, right? Say, so you were told this, meanwhile it was actually this, right? And, you know, to give people the you know, something substantial that will aid them in reconsidering what they think they know. And which is something that Five Little Indians did for so many people. You would be amazed at the number of people that have reached out to me, and, you know, in a, you know, if I had to sort of make them all the same comment, it would be, I just didn't know this was happening, but now I'll never forget. And driving people towards their own journey of self-education or re-education about the reality of Indigenous people in Canada. And so that's what I wrote these essays for, right? Is to say, well, take a look at this. Tell me what you think. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. So, but they're very conversational. They're not academic essays. And so I hope that people will avail themselves.
What I hear in it is actually you're growing a forest. You're growing all these trees. So your essays are planting seeds so people can go and grow.
I've got all these seedlings. Come and get my seedlings and just carry on. Yeah. You know, and I feel, you know, I don't know if you hear this in your life, but I hear it all the time when people are talking about, you know, reconciliation and, you know, what can we do? And, you know, my overarching response is take responsibility for your own education, but intensely, right? Like, don't ask me, you know, what you need to do. Okay, you've listened to something that I've had to say, and it's moved you to question. So just carry on your own little quest of questioning. There's lots of resources out there now, right? But I think it's really important to insist that people be responsible for their own education, that, you know, because if they're not, then they can just say, well, you know, nobody will tell me about it. Nobody will teach me about it, and just abandon, you know, any kind of endeavor to truly understand and to truly make change because somebody else didn't spoon feed them, you know, what they need to know. So, yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think as one of the actions of truth and reconciliation, that's one piece. And I also, I think the ongoingness, the ongoing nature of people taking initiative on their own education, right? To not feel like, now I've got it, right? Right. And to recognize that it's an ongoing.
Well, and it is, right? Because everything is in a state of flux. That is the first law of the universe, is that everything is changing constantly. Nothing is the same this second to that second. And, you know, we run into trouble when we try to anchor ourselves in a moment, whether that moment is an era a thought or an ideology, or you know, when we try to anchor ourselves in something, then we drown. Mm-hmm. Right? And you know, we stop growing, we remain stuck, and we stop learning, and you know, we become less mm-hmm. fluid than we should be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Even the tree, when it stops growing and it falls down, it still contributes to all of the life around it.
Yes.
Right?
Well, that's right.
It remains an important part of...
Oh, two of my favorite things about trees, right? One is nursery trees, right? Where you see the trees that have fallen in the forest and there are trees that are growing out of them. Like you still see, you know, you still see the trunk of the tree or the, you know, the trunk of the tree, but it's fallen, but then all these seedlings are coming out of it, right? And the other one is when trees take over. I've got a couple of photographs I've taken that I just go, oh, I love it. And it's like this, one of them is on the way to Batosh, and there's a car, it looks like it's about maybe 1940s or 1950s. It's just an old wreck, right? And there's this beautiful tree that has grown up through this car, right? And it's just, you know, there's you know, the skeleton of the car, and there's this gorgeous tree, like just so alive and vibrant, and you know, I just, you know, I love it. There was another one that I really like. I have a photograph somewhere of it, and it's a stop sign, and this, you know how the stop signs, you have the sign and then there's the post, and the post is open, right? It's like, I don't know how to describe it, but there was a sapling growing up through the post of the stop sign, right? And I watched it over a period of years, and it's all greenery up above the stop sign, right? And I absolutely love it. I just say, thank you. You know, because if I went and modified a sign, it's like they're modifying modern technology, right? And if I did that, I'd probably end up with a ticket or something, right? If I painted a tree on the stop sign, I'd be in trouble. But when the tree just makes the stop sign a tree, right, it's a totally different thing. But I just love those moments when I see that. You know, it's the same thing as, you know, Coyote on Rodeo Drive, right? So, yeah.
Yeah, it's a different kind of belonging. Or another kind of belonging, maybe.
It's so powerful, right? Because it's like, they don't need permission. They don't need permission to take over that car or to grow up around the stop sign. They just do, right? And because they just are. It's in their DNA. Mm-hmm. So, whereas we, in the world we're in now, we need permission to do anything. Anything. And if we try, you know, if we try to do something that is fundamentally in the interests of the earth, we often end up arrested. Yeah. And I think of the Wet'suwet'en.
The land defenders taking on such a huge frontline responsibility on everyone's behalf, and the legislation against that, against them.
Mm-hmm. Well, and that's actually one of the essays that I do in the book, talks about the rule of law and how the rule of law is selective, right? And the Wet'suwet'en are my example, right? Because it was the Delgamuukw case where the highest court in the land said, you know, that their title had not been, their sovereignty had not been extinguished. They had not relinquished their sovereignty, and their title and rights had not been extinguished. But as soon as they tried to exercise those rights and that title, then somehow the rule of law no longer applies. And you know, mm-hmm. and I raised the question about how can a Canadian legal institution rule against itself, rule against the foundations of its own institutions, right? It can't. And that's what systemic change means. It means rooting out all of that so that, you know, when the rule of law says, yes, they are sovereign, yes, they have not relinquished their rights, then everything else needs to fall into place. It can't just be words, right? If it's just words, then why bother? Don't say them. And yeah, so that's, and did you know that only 11% of the entire land base in Canada is privately owned? 11%.
And the rest of it is Crown. Crown
is either federal, it's almost half and half between federal and Crown land, or federal and provincial Crown land. And do you know where the term Crown land came from? It's so great. I'll start out by saying that one of the fundamental things in a democracy is that arbitrariness is considered entirely wrong. Laws will be overturned because they are arbitrary, and arrests, you know, certain things will all be considered wrong if they are arbitrary. But when it comes to Crown land, where that came from was in the 1100s in Britain, where the King of England said only the king can own land. It was a decree, an arbitrary decree that only the king can own land. That's where the principle of Crown land came from. So how can we call ourselves a leading democratic nation when at the very foundation of our country and our laws and our institutions is an arbitrary, a completely arbitrary law, right? And, you know, so it's like, think about that, everybody. It's like, you know,
it's so lazy.
Well, yeah, and just some crazy king that said, only I shall own the land, right? You know, and where does that come from? The divine right of kings, right? Where, when mm-hmm. it was believed that, you know, kings were, you know, the left hand of God, right? And that's, you know, really? That is the foundation of our society? Well, yes, it is.
Yeah, that hierarchical thinking is so damaging because it means sort of like the equivalent of when you talk to your parent or ask your parent for something and they say no, and you say, but why? And they, because I said so.
Because and I said so. Like
it's just lazy. It's yeah. not skillful. It's not big thinking. It's not relational. Like it's so problematic. And we have, I mean, that is what that is the fundamental, that's the foundation of colonialism.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
Crown
it
is because land. I said so.
Crown land. Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Well, yeah.
Doesn't make me dislike it anymore.
Or like it anymore. But, you know, well, and it's when you yeah. take it, when you take it even a step further, okay, that's why when there is, even with the Chilcotin, and their decision where they were found to have title to their territories, it is still held that their title is a burden on the Crown title, okay? And that's like having a lien against your house, okay? That it's the same thing. Your title is not absolute, okay? The government can come and take your house at any time, really, okay? And that's the same thing with Aboriginal title, is that it's still considered like a lien on the Crown title. Crown still maintains the underlying title. Okay, so is it title? If it's not title, what is it, right? Mm-hmm. It's still a conditional recognition because it's in that mm-hmm. context of Crown land, of that arbitrary decree of who can and cannot own the land, right? So, mm-hmm. I mean, not that we were ever thinking about owning land to begin with, right? But, well, no, we didn't own the land. I think about, you know, in particular, Potlatch people. Even with Potlatch people, they didn't own the land. They owned the responsibility for identifiable pieces of land that coincided mm-hmm. with names and, you know, so on and so forth. But that wasn't owning the land itself. That was recognizing the responsibility to specific land, but with some very, very, very clear, well-established historical distinctions between, okay, Niska are responsible for this land and Tsimshian are responsible for this land, right? With the, mm-hmm. you know, the boundaries between nations and so on. But mm-hmm. It's all very interesting when you just have the opportunity, which I've had and I'm thankful for, to just think about this stuff, right?
Yeah.
You know, like with Pretendians, okay? One of these essays is about Pretendians, and I was just racking my brain about how to, you know, how can I explain this in a way that people will understand it, right? Because somebody said to me, and it was an Indigenous person, said to me, you know, the word Indigenous is so ambiguous. And I said, it is not, right? You know, in fact, it's one of the few words that is absolutely not ambiguous in the English language. It just means a very specific thing. And so I was thinking about it. I was thinking about in Five Little Indians, where I used the analogy where George is telling Clara that she's not a weed, right? That she's an indigenous flower, right? And so I think about that was one of those moments for me, right? And so I was thinking about that. I thought, okay, so what is an indigenous plant anyway, right? So, you know, I Google around. And the Audubon Society has defined an indigenous plant, and we're talking about North America, okay, an indigenous plant that existed in North America prior to European colonization. That's an indigenous plant.
That's very specific.
Yeah, I thought, okay, so there's the analogy. That's what indigenous people are, the people that were here prior to colonization. Okay, so, but then they also have naturalized plants, okay? And a naturalized plant is a plant that has, in effect, been adopted by the ecosystem, right? It was a plant that wasn't there before European colonization, but it hasn't taken over the environment. It has been welcomed by the indigenous ecosystem, okay? And so the analogy that I draw there, those are the people that are adopted into community, okay? Is that they're not indigenous, but they've been welcomed because they're not trying to destroy it. They fit in and they're welcomed and loved and cherished, but they're not indigenous, right? And then there is the invasive species, right? And the invasive species, and it's beautiful the way it's described, is described as, you know, basically as an unwanted species that destroys everything, right? And that's the Pretendian. Okay, so that's the analogy that I was able to draw to try and explain, you know. So when somebody has chosen this, you know, fraudulent, you know, ethnic theft of Pretendianism, they are in fact an invasive species. They are drawing all of the resources from indigenous people and taking everything that they possibly can at the expense of the indigenous plants and the naturalized plants, right? I thought, maybe now people will understand it, right? I thought it was a pretty good analogy. I was just walking around my little house laughing my face off when I really, like, when I read, you know, that it's, you know, what existed here, the plants that were here before European colonization. It's like, how clear, you know, could you be more clear, right? Yeah.
So. Yeah, I'm pretty confounded by people when they somehow manage to be confused about Pretendians, and I'm not sure how that's confusing at all. Like, it's very, very clear to me and yeah. to most of our people.
Yeah.
And yeah,
I don't think that people are confused. I don't think they're genuinely confused. I think that they're conflicted, okay? And I think they're conflicted for all sorts of unfortunate reasons, mostly wrapping around influence, privilege, and money. That when you have these Pretendians that are that have leverage okay, that can generate resources for people or organizations. I think people become conflicted, but they know. I mean, give me a break. Yeah. They know. Yeah. They're not confused. They're just conflicted, which is different. They have conflicted loyalties.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That's an important distinction. Yeah.
Yeah.
I feel like, much like all of our conversations, we could sit here for 100 years and there'd still be more to talk about. And I want to just say, you know, before we sign off our virtual space conversation, that in diving into the waters of these conversations, part of what really excites me in speaking with you and in listening to you is that we get to go to very deep places. Mm-hmm. And I think where some people might find it scary or uncomfortable, it actually feels very joyous and hopeful.
And fun. And
I just want to say I'm so glad. I'm so glad to be here in conversation with you. And I'm so grateful for you and the way you walk in the world.
Well, thank you, Jada. And I just have to say, you know, when my kid died, it was a turning point. I mean, I was already kind of that way anyway, right? Where there was sort of a natural disinclination to engage in bullshit. And, you know, that I have always been looking for what's real, what is authentic, what is contributory and positive. But when Jay died, it was like, okay, that's it. I will never have a superficial conversation again in my life. I have no tolerance for wasting spirit, right? We are, we are, before anything else, we are spirit. And I don't want to waste that in things that don't generate something good, right? And it doesn't have to be complex or intellectual or any of those kinds of things, but just good, right? There has to be, and I just imagine if we all did that, if we were all dedicated to increasing the goodness quotient in the world, and we all could be. So I welcome these. Well, I just don't tolerate anything else but this. Yeah. Really, I minimize my exposure to anything other than, you know, this kind of exchange. And, you know, and I mean, that means that my life is quite solitary in many ways, but I'm okay with that, right? Totally okay with it. Yeah. Save my resources for moments like these.
Yeah, I understand that. I appreciate that. And I really appreciate spending time together today. Thank you.
Me too. Thank you.
I'll for sure read this book of essays.
Okay. Yeah, it's called Truth Telling, 7 Conversations About Indigenous Reality in Canada.
When does it come out?
May 30th.
Okay.
I'll get you an ARC, though. I'll get you an advanced reading copy.
Ooh, I'd love that. That's exciting.
Okay.
Yeah. Thanks, Michelle. Take really good, gentle care.
Thank you, my dears.
So that wraps up our 2-part conversation with Michelle Good. And please come back again and see us in our next episode, where we have a wonderful conversation in store with Jenna Brewer.